Hi friends, today in this class, let us discuss about the cephalopelvic disproportion. Let us see what is the definition of CPD or cephalopelvic disproportion. It's a disparity in relation between the head and the pelvis. That is, if there is a disproportion between the fetal head and the maternal pelvis, that is known as a cephalopelvic disproportion. Sometimes the head may be large, or the pelvis may be small, or sometimes the baby is maybe having normal size, and if the pelvis is small, in these cases this CPD can occur. Now let us see how we can diagnose the cephalopelvic disproportion. For diagnosing the CPD, we can use clinical method, X-ray pelvimetry and cephalometry. In the clinical method, first one is abdominal method. In the clinical abdominal method, what we are supposed to do means keep the patient in the dorsal position. You just see this picture. See, keep the patient in the dorsal position and slightly separate and flex the thighs and grasp the fetal head by using the left hand of the examiner, and the middle finger of the right hand should be placed over the upper border of the symphysis pubis. Keep like this, and by holding this fetal head by using the left hand, you just push the fetal head downward, that is into the pelvis. And the inferences how to diagnose a CPD by using this method we can see now. First one is, if there is no disproportion, that is, if there is no cephalopelvic disproportion, when you are pushing the head downward by using the left hand, it will be entering into the, that is, the head will be entering into the pelvis without overlapping the symphysis pubis. That is, the parietal bone of the fetal head will not be overlapping the symphysis pubis. It will just enter easily. And if moderate disproportion, moderate cephalopelvic disproportion is there, means head can be pushed down with a slight but slight overlapping of the bone, and it can be evidenced by touch on the under surface of the fingers. Already in the position we have seen the two fingers, that is the middle finger and the index finger, we are keeping over the upper border of the symphysis pubis. And when you're pushing, if the baby's head is touching on your right hand, that is touching on the two fingers, on these fingers, or the finger which you have kept on the upper border of the symphysis pubis, it shows that moderate disproportion is there. And if severe disproportion is there, means head cannot be pushed down. Instead of going into the symphysis pubis, what will happen means this parietal bone will just displace the fingers that you have kept over the symphysis pubis. So that shows the severe degree of disproportion. This is the abdominal method. Now in the next we can see the abdominovaginal method. See, in the abdominovaginal method, one hand you will be keeping over the abdomen and other hand you will be introducing through the vagina. See, the left hand is over the abdomen and the right hand is introducing through the, that is, two fingers of the middle and index finger of the right hand will be introducing into the vagina, and thumb you are supposed to keep over the upper border of the symphysis pubis. Keep the fingertips at the level of the ischial spines. That is, these two fingers, already I have told you, you are supposed to introduce into the vagina. These two fingers, that is, the tips of these two fingers should be at the level of the ischial spine. And the thumb, already I have told you, you are supposed to keep over the upper border of the symphysis pubis. And grasp the head of the baby by using the left hand, and the same as like the previous method, we are just pushing the baby downward by using the left hand. And remember one thing, before this abdominal method and abdominovaginal method, make sure that the bladder and bowel is emptied. Otherwise, one thing, it will produce discomfort for the mother, and second thing, if the rectum is packed fully, it will not allow the descent of the baby downward. And how to diagnose a cephalopelvic disproportion by using the abdominovaginal method means, see, already I told you that the two fingers are at the level of the ischial spine, thumb is over the upper border of the symphysis pubis, and the left hand is over the fetal head. And by using the left hand, if you are pushing the baby into the symphysis pubis or into the pelvis, if the head is entering up to the level of the ischial spine, if the fetal head is entering up to the level of the ischial spine, of course it will be touching the tips of the fingers that you have kept over the at the level of the ischial spine. And if it is reaching up to the level of the ischial spine, it shows that there is no cephalopelvic disproportion. And if the head can be pushed down but it is not able to push up to the level of the ischial spine, slight overlapping of the parietal bone will be there over the symphysis pubis. This shows slight disproportion. And in the case of severe disproportion, it won't be possible for you to push the head downward. Instead of that, the head will be, when you're pushing the head will be displacing the thumb which you have kept over the upper border of the symphysis pubis. And the other two methods for diagnosing the cephalopelvic disproportion includes X-ray pelvimetry, MRI and CT scan of the maternal pelvis. And now we can see the effect of contracted pelvis on pregnancy and labor. During the pregnancy, if contracted pelvis is there, means there is a chance for retroversion of the uterus. The uterus, that is the upper segment of the uterus, upper pole of the uterus, or the uterine fundus will come downward or will get retroverted backward, and it may coat inside the maternal pelvis. And when this upper portion or the fundus is getting coat, there is a chance for erosion or there is a chance for damage of the tissues over there. That is known as the incarceration. Retroversion means it is a upside movement or backward movement, and it is coming, the fundus of the uterus will be coming up to the level of, or coming flexing backward, and it will come up to the level of the symphysis pubis. And the next one is pendulous abdomen. See, instead of directing the fetus into the pelvis, it will be, in the case of disproportion, it won't be possible for the baby to enter into the pelvis. So what will happen when it is coming downward? It will be pushing the abdomen outward. So there is a chance for pendulous abdomen. And the next one is malpresentation. If the head is coming downward and if there is no space over there to accommodate the head, usually the baby may change the position. So there is a chance for malpresentation. And during the time of labor, if the head is the presenting part, we know that the head is a well-fitted presenting part. And other than the head, if any other portions are there, the other presenting parts, for example, if it is breech, shoulder, if it is face presentation, in all those cases, it is not a well-fitted presenting part. So there is a chance for early rupture of the membrane. And in the same way, if the presenting part is not well-fitted to the pelvis, when the membranes are rupturing, or when the uterus is contracting, there is a chance for the escape of umbilical cord through the sides of the presenting part. And there is a chance for slow dilatation of the cervix. If the presenting part is well fitted, it will come and hit on the cervix, and it leads to the dilatation of the cervix. And if it is not a well fitted presenting part, there is a chance for slow dilatation of the cervix. And there is a chance for increased tendency of prolonged labor. See, if the presentation is a malpresentation, if the cervix is slowly dilating, of course there is a chance for prolonged labor also. And increased chance of operative inference. If malpresentation is there, or if the uterus is not contracting effectively, or if severe disproportion is there and if engagement is not occurring, in that cases naturally we will go for the other alternatives to ensure the safety of the mother and baby. So sometimes you may go for the forceps, or sometimes you may go for the cesarean, or sometimes you may go for the vacuum, like that. And there is a chance for postpartum hemorrhage and sepsis. When the duration of the labor is getting prolonged and if the membranes are rupturing earlier, when you are doing the repeated vaginal examination, you may introduce infection into the vagina. And actually these membranes and amniotic fluid, membranes are giving protection to the baby, and when it is rupturing earlier, that protection from infection is losing over there. So the chance for infection is there. And second one, PPH. During the course of labor, I told you that there is a chance for prolonged labor and slow cervical dilatation. And if the labor is getting prolonged, what will happen? The uterus will be contracting again and again, and finally the uterine muscles will get exhausted. And after the delivery, actually, if the uterus is not contracting effectively, there is a chance for postpartum hemorrhage. Next is fetal hazards. The fetal hazards include trauma and asphyxia. See, if the duration of the labor is getting prolonged, there is a chance for fetal asphyxia. And if you are going for the operative inferences, because of that, there is a chance for getting trauma to the baby. Next, let us see how can we manage the cephalopelvic disproportion. If the disproportion is a minor degree, you can try for the normal labor. And if there is a moderate degree of disproportion is there, you can go for the preterm induction of the labor. See, if you are inducing the labor little earlier, naturally the size of the baby will be less and the presenting diameters also will be less. So that may allow the baby to pass through the pelvis if there is only moderate disproportion is there. So before inducing the labor, you should make sure the fetal maturity and fetal lung maturity also. And if only moderate disproportion is there, means you can just induce the labor just 2 to 3 weeks before the term. And the next one is elective cesarean. At term, if you are feeling that the pelvis is not adequate and fetal maturity is there, and if you are not expecting a normal delivery, you can go for the elective cesarean section. This you can do in the case of severe degree of disproportion and even in the case of moderate degree of disproportion also. Next is trial labor. This is the induction of spontaneous labor in moderate degree of CPD in an institution under the supervision with watchful expectancy, hoping for a vaginal delivery. It is nothing. In the case of moderate cephalopelvic disproportion, we are just trying for the normal delivery with all facilities. See, when you are trying for that, you should make sure that an obstetrician is available, a pediatrician is available, hospital is having the space for doing emergency cesarean or for the operative delivery. After ensuring all those things and after ensuring the presence of an expert, if you are trying for the labor, that is known as a trial labor. That is, you are just trying for the labor. And the contraindications of the trial labor include mid pelvic and outlet contractions, elderly primary gravida mothers, mal presentation, post maturity, previous cesarean section, preeclampsia and eclampsia. In all these cases, you should not try for the trial labor. And when you are conducting the trial labor, onset of labor should be spontaneous. And once if the labor process has started, you should not give oral feeds to the mother, because at any time, if the outcome is not an expected thing or if the normal progress of labor is not occurring, you are supposed to go for the operative delivery. So you should keep the mother nil orally and you should observe for the progress of the labor. If there is a delay, you can go for the amniotomy, or you can rupture the membrane and watch for the maternal and fetal condition. That is uterine contractions, dilatation of the cervix, maternal pulse, BP, everything you should check. And in the case of fetus, you should see mainly the fetal heart rate. And the outcome depends on the degree of pelvic contraction, shape of the pelvis, presentation of the baby, effectiveness of uterine contractions and tolerance of the patient. If all these things are favorable, you can expect a normal delivery. And the unfavorable features include appearance of abnormal contraction. See, during the course of labor, when you are waiting, if uterus has started with abnormal contraction, or if the presentation is not a normal presentation, or if the membranes are rupturing earlier, these things are unfavorable features. If formation of caput is there, or if signs of fetal distress is there, that is also coming under the unfavorable condition. And the advantages of trial labor: unnecessary cesarean section you can avoid, and you can eliminate the premature induction of the baby also. And the disadvantages include: there is a chance for increased perinatal mortality and morbidity. There is a chance for increased maternal morbidity also. Thank you for watching this video. Thank you.